group, sociologist Randy Blazak. Randy, I want to get your take, given you've studied hate groups and white nationalists, this movement, for decades, I know. What do you think is driving this movement right now?
Well, what we're seeing is this new part of the white supremacist movement connected to the alt-right that have been kind of in the shadows for the last 8 years, and they are out, and it's like a snowball that's just been building and building and building, and it's just, it seems to be kind of an unstoppable force, and certainly that's how they see themselves. They see themselves as a part of a second American revolution to take the country back, and so I think we're going to be seeing a lot more of this as we go on.
You grew up in the South. You've met with white nationalists. Are there any common characteristics you've noticed in people who spend years in these groups? Any common life experiences?
Sure. I mean, many of them, it's a complex phenomenon, but many of them see the world changing too fast. They don't know how to process the changes in our demographics, the change in sexual identity, the change in our economy. I mean, these are things that are really transforming the country in a quick pace that they're a little bit out of sorts, so they have this notion of going back. They want to take the country back or make the country great again. It's always about going back to something where they think the world makes sense. And so there's that pushback, and the pushback happens on the playground and bullying against kids who are immigrants or Muslims, and it happens in the political spectrum, but then it happens sort of on the streets where the alt-right really sort of gets their megaphone and gets out and gets their message heard by a lot of people, including through the media.
We've been talking about how the president reacted to the violence. He strongly condemned the hatred and bigotry on display. His opponents and Republicans, too, are ripping apart some of those comments today, no matter where one lands on the political spectrum. Randy, is there really a correct or an incorrect way to talk about these hate groups?
Well, there is. I mean, the fact is that they are responding to the changes, but the changes are about creating a society that's more just and more equal. And for those folks, some of that feels like oppression. And so it's not fair to equate both sides of the debate as equally invested in some type of dominant narrative, or that, you know, that they're equally violent. There is a group that is trying to turn back the clock, and I think the problem is when we see those as two sort of sides of the same coin, the anti-fascist and the fascist are just sort of locked in this mortal combat. But there's a larger historical context by which this is happening, and I think the alt-right is trying to hijack that discussion about who is the victim in American history, and for them it's white men, and that's just not the reality.
So if you were President Trump's speechwriter today, what would be the very first line, the first words out of the president's mouth regarding the situation in Charlottesville, if you were to advise that?
I think it's acknowledging the importance of the diversity in this country, the fact that we are stronger together, and that if we do want to come together, it's going to take people acknowledging the history of oppression and racism that we have before we even take the next step. It's sort of acknowledging that truth is key to the whole thing.
What do you think he could have done differently then? Because he did speak of unity. He did speak of condemning hatred, bigotry, violence. Do you think that there's something he could have said to send a more poignant message, to these groups?
Sure. And it's acknowledging the experience of those people who have experienced racism, that it's not an even playing field. I mean, some people think that because we had a black president, the problem of racism is just a thing of the past. In fact, it happens every day in this country. And you have to acknowledge the experience of those people, including those people who are having issues with law enforcement or job discrimination or housing discrimination or just, again, on the playground. You have to acknowledge the real lived pain and trauma of those folks to make a real call for unity, because if you don't do that, it just looks like a lot of a dog and pony show.
All right, Randy Blazak, we appreciate your time and your thoughts. Thank you.